Hey guys, Killer Minis here. And yeah, I want to do a Zombicide tactics tip for everybody. I've been playing lots of games lately, and I'd like to go ahead and put out a series on individual tactical tips that I've found after, I don't know, roughly 30 or 40 games. So here we go. So the tactics tip for today is positional awareness. And yeah, it's kind of a technical term. Basically, it just means, in a nutshell, when you're done with your turn, try to maintain at least a one zone buffer between you and any active zombie. The one exception to that is to runners because they can cover so much ground. And we go back to a blue brush here, and we got a nice green area here, a free zone there. In all areas, we got a free zone away from, and this would count as free, there's nothing there, from every one of my survivors. I don't have anybody adjacent, at least in forms of a walker, and currently there's no runners out there. So this is really a great scenario to be, a great situation to try to maintain. Now, you're not always going to be able to do that, depending on how you roll and how you gear your people up. In my case, I'm playing solo, so it's a little easier to go ahead and get people to agree with what I want because it's just me. But if you're playing with other people, you're gonna have to try to convince them and tactically, you know, what's the best choice. And you know how that goes. With a cooperative game, you can pretty much throw that out the window. At least, you know, 40, 30, 40% of the time. So let's see here. Here's another end to a zombie turn. You can see they moved in on me from the last position, and there again I was able to take them all out. For this particular map, the big part about this was having these four spawn points. All right, so I purposely kind of held a position as far as way as far away as I could. You know, in this case, and this map was a little hard. But this was kind of my defensive zone. It was a four-room area that I tried to hold down. And that actually, for this particular mission, worked pretty well. I was able to emerge completely victorious with six survivors in this scenario or mission, which is the 300 mission if you haven't played it yet, by the way. So we had over 300 kills, and I did not suffer a survivor casualty, even a wound even. So if anything, I might have been a bit too conservative because I really wanted to prove the point. Must be after, this is the end of a zombie turn. And you can see the zombies that were in place at the spawn had basically moved up into a threat. So that's what I'm trying to show you there, is that if you leave that buffer, then that free buffer you have, as soon as they get their move, they're going to be on you, right? Or one square closer, obviously. So what you're really trying to account for is that extra turn. So even in this case, I probably should have used red there, but we've got two threats circled in green. And during this, after they move, had they have spawned a free walker card, the one person that would have been hurt would have been El Cholo here. So he got a little too close. But actually, in this game, he had the mask, so I took that risk for a reason. So let's go back through this, and basically my frames are taken. These are in order to end of zombie turn and end of player turn. You can watch these guys show up. Oh, how did I do that? And then disappear. So there's the end of a zombie turn. You get the abomination barreling down on us right there. That was an interesting turn. Now it started getting a little crazy. We started moving off into the yellow phase. This is where it gets a little bit dicier. So this is the end of a zombie turn, and you can see they were on us. But there again, I was utilizing that buffer. So end of the turn, end of the player turn, and you can see I got a nice buffer zone between me and every single threat. Now you might say, well, what about this abomination here? But if you look at the map, you can't go diagonally in the rooms. You can't do diagonal movement inside the building. So he's really two spaces away. So that's a really good example there of maintaining that buffer. That one zone buffer is critical. So now here's another turn. Actually, yeah, that was right after we killed the abomination. Yeah, it got a little crazy. You can kind of get an idea of how this mission went. But see if I can find you another good example. It'd have been better if I knew exactly. Look at that, how we cleared that completely out. This is where they really started getting hot with their skills. And having six players in this mission really, really helps. So that's pretty much it. Let me go ahead and see if I can't jump to the end screen. And yeah, just as an interesting note, I actually really screwed up, even though I talk about tactics. One of the things that I messed up with is I had pulled El Cholo. He came out this door, and for some reason I decided to do that to try to make a move. Oh, I know what it was. He needed four more kills to try to get him into the red. And the abomination I knew was barreling down on me. He was due soon. So I wanted to try to chase him over here to get these final kills. And what ended up happening was he got stuck at the spawn point. So then I had to commit four other survivors to jump in there in hopes that if there were to spawn and then get like a free activation, that I might be able to keep some survivors intact. But the worst card in the world came up for me. I ended up getting two walkers per spawn point. And so basically I ended up with two walkers here. Or hold on, actually I think it was more than two. Excuse me, eight walkers and four zombies. And when it was all done and said, oh, there was a free turn that came in, that's how they jumped on me. And they were just completely surrounded. And it's probably my best Zombicide moment yet. These guys completely chopped their way through that without harm. I probably took two shots of that. Look at that. The very next turn, the end of the player phase, they were all gone. I basically cleared almost the entire building. And I effectively got my skill that I wanted from El Cholo. When he hits the red, he gets that plus one to die roll on the melee. Or excuse me, plus one to damage. So that allows him to go ahead and kill that abomination that was rolling down on me. So that was completely epic. I'm going to probably post. This is my final. Is this my final frame? Probably post the. No, it's not. The video itself in its entirety with maybe a little bit of editing for those that are interested. But I really. Sometimes I'm. I hesitate to put up a 2 or 3 hour video. That's pretty long. So I got to find a way to chop it up a little bit. So it'll be available at some point. So here's the final frame. Yeah, I basically beat the game. Actually, that isn't the final frame. Yeah, this was the very last turn for the survivors. And they were completely surrounded. And I only needed five more kills to beat. Or to get the 300 mark of the score, which means you win. That's the object of this particular mission. So it really became, well, who is going to be the MVP with the most kills? So it was pretty dicey. But in the end, let's see if we can, let me zoom in on that just a little bit for you. In the end, as you can see, ended up doing a pretty darn good job. I basically wiped everybody out that was in this entire area. They went crazy. Some of these, a couple of my characters, look at all the dead figures over here. That was on one turn. It was crazy. He had a plus one to die roll, and of course he had dual wielding submachine guns, and he rolled phenomenal. So he just tore it up. I mean, everybody did a great job, but he actually won MVP with the most number of kills. I forget what it was. It was something like 71 or 72 total kills, which is crazy. So anyway, I had a lot of fun in the mission. this video wasn't really about that. Just figured if you're watching this long, I'd go ahead and share it to you. But just know what I was referring to earlier, positional awareness. Even in this case, if the game would have continued, which it was over, I still left a one zone buffer in every direction. And honestly, that was completely not by design. I wanted to be careless and just try to get the high score, but you know, the bullets started flying and the swords and came out and started slashing and hacking, and next thing you know, there was nothing really left to kill except these guys that were all the way over here. So good stuff anyway. So hey, thanks for watching. Please, if you haven't already, make sure you subscribe so you can get updates to, you know, my regular posting of videos and whatnot. And let your friends know or whatever. Get the word out. Like to try to do some live gaming with some individuals. So if you're interested in playing live, I've got a whole setup to what I do with a couple cameras, and I handle it through Google+. For a while, I was telling people to add me on Google+, and I think the best way to do it now is to just go ahead and make sure you send me a private message through YouTube. So that'll specifically hit an inbox that really isn't used very often. And just let me know, hey, my name is so-and-so and I'd like to play live. I'm in the Pacific time zone, whatever time zone, let me know. And then give me some availability times that you're around and I'll shoot you a message and we'll try to hook up a game. You don't even need the game itself. I have everything. So if this is something that you're looking at playing, the only thing I ask is that you do kind of have a decent idea for the rules. You don't have to have it mastered, but you might want to go through. You can download the rules on Guillotine Games and get a start there. All right, so that's it for now. Thanks, Kill the Minis out.